joyous moments alone. 'Cause it feels so good when I let my water flow. Drip drop and I cannot stop, can't stop, no, I said no. Drip drop and I cannot stop, can't stop, I cry for you, cry for you. I cry because I cannot help it, so it runs and it falls and ain't no stopping at all. I like your song, I like it when
just gravitational. It's my great honour to welcome you all.
It is a very prestigious award. It means the world to me.
They have great senses of humour.
I like to reveal parts of history to them before. I love making history come alive.
They are some of the best people that you can come across.
To help them open their hearts.
I always come back to this quote. How can we be role models to learners if we're not learners ourselves?
It's quite useful to get out of our bubbles, not our COVID ones, and sort of see what else is out there.
By sharing best practice, we can see the whole picture. We can see what really matters.
Easy to forget how much has to happen behind the front lines.
As a global schools group, Cognita educates over 55,000 students across 12 countries. We're proud to be Wellbeing Partner at this year's Festival of Education, and we want to share the work that we're doing to prioritise children's wellbeing. This starts with a clear understanding of what wellbeing is. We looked at the evidence and created a simple Be Well charter that everyone can use day to day. It gives a clear definition of well-being and then focuses on specific contributors that influence it. Discover our full Be Well Charter video and other resources to use with your students and families at cognita.com.
I really try to not look at myself as just a science teacher. I feel like as a teacher, it's very important to help students grow and develop outside of your lessons. A single teacher believing in you and really believing in you. One teacher doing that can have a large impact, but if you have one or two or three all telling you that and really, really believing in it, it makes you feel like you can achieve anything in the world, honestly.
Welcome to this Festival of Education keynote session, part of the annual Festival of Education, taking place online from the 16th to the 30th of June. This year's festival is free for all teachers and educationalists across education in the UK and beyond. This has only been possible thanks to the support of our incredible partners. A huge thank you to our headline partner, Pearson. Our festival partners, BBC Bitesize, Cognita and Teach First. Our literary festival partner, Bloomsbury Publishing, and our organising partner, Wellington College, the home of the Festival of Education. We'd also like to thank our incredible speakers. Over 200 leading educationalists and thought leaders will be providing sessions at this year's festival. On behalf of the audience and organisers, thank you. It's time to sit back and get set for our upcoming keynote session. If you wish to ask a question during this session, please head over to our Slido page to submit questions and vote for your favourites. Enjoy this Festival of Education keynote session.
Good afternoon. My name is Lucy Kellaway, and I'm going to be chairing a panel on how experienced career changers into teaching can benefit our schools. Now, I'm very glad to be able to sort this issue out because 4 to 5 years ago, I co-founded an organisation called Now Teach. And Now Teach, we had conceived of as a sort of teach first in reverse. What we would do is scoop up experienced people who had spent their lives, you know, maybe working in banking, as lawyers, civil servants, whatever, and make their final career act in the classroom. I wanted to call this Teach Last, which I still actually think is a hilarious and brilliant idea, but I was persuaded that it sounded very bad because it made it sound as if the teachers were going to actually die. In my earlier life, I was a columnist on the FT, And so what better than to use the FT as a platform in those early days to find these potential career changers? So I wrote about it, trying to encourage these people who had maybe just had enough of being corporate lawyers and management consultants and make them become teachers. Various people concluded, therefore, that the point of this charity was to benefit the career changers themselves. You know, poor dears, bless them. You know, they'd got a bit bored of their previous careers and now wanted to be teachers. Now that, let me say, and that's what this panel is going to put to rights, is not the point of it at all. The point of doing this is that there is and was even worse than a very bad shortage of teachers. And relative oldies like me was a seam that had not yet been mined. And this seemed crazy given how many of us there are and how long we have got left to live. So that is why Now Teach was founded. And on the panel with me this evening, I have three real live Now Teachers, as well as the head of a MAT who has seen it all from the other end. So first of all, what I'm going to do is ask each of them to introduce themselves, and then we will move into the discussion. So Anne-Marie, starting with you, off you go. Can you please tell us what you're teaching, how long you've been doing it for, and what you used to do with your life before that?
Hello, so I'm Anne-Marie Lawler. I'm a recovering senior civil servant, having worked in a number of departments, including the Department for Education. And I now teach at Trinity Academy in Brixton, where I teach Latin, I teach French, and I am the careers coordinator.
Thanks very much. So Peter, you were also, Peter was in that very first cohort with Anne-Marie, and I've always slightly had it against Peter. I said that nobody would drop out in that first year. Peter said that I wasn't right. Alas, Peter won, but we're still proud of how many people are still with it. Peter, off you go.
My name is Peter Jerram. I'm a maths teacher at Oasis Academy Shirley Park in Croydon. I'm also head of year 12. I became a head of year 12 in my NQT year. I've been doing that for the last 18 months or so. I used to be an investment banker working in the city, trading foreign exchange options. Did that for nearly 20 years of my life before becoming a teacher 4 years ago.
And Kashras?
Hello, I'm Kashras Zaman. I'm teaching at one of the Harris Academies in South London, also teaching maths like Peter. I was 1 year behind the rest of you, so I started in 2018, so waited to hear the stories from you before formally committing, and this is now coming up to my third year of teaching. Before this, I worked in the city as a corporate lawyer. I was a partner at a city law firm, and then decided to switch to teaching maths here in South London.
Excellent. I've in all of the excitement, I've forgotten to actually say what I'm doing. So I was a journalist for 30 years on the FT, and now I teach economics at one of the strictest academy schools ever in Hackney. So Ian, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ian Hunter. I'm the chief exec of the Knowledge Schools Trust, within which sits the West London Free School, which is one of the first free schools to open back in 2011. In fact, it's our 10th anniversary this year, which is we'll be celebrating in September. My background was in companies like Pepsi and BP, and I worked for a number of large American management consultancies, and I've been involved in the education sector by accident initially, but I've been there now for 8 years.
Can you just tell us what your exposure so far to Now Teachers has been?
We've had six Now Teachers through our system, of whom four remain with us and have been with us now for, I think, 4 years.
Great. Okay. Right. Look, I've divided the discussion up to try and keep it manageable into various perfectly formed chunks. The first and the most important is about the children, about the students. The question really that I want us to answer is what we offer our students different to what is offered by your bog standard teacher. And by that, I do not mean to be derogative in any way, but most of the trainee teachers are quite young, and some of them are the age of two of my children who are trainee teachers, and they're in their early 20s. Do we have something different to offer the children? And if so, what is it? Kojal, can I start with you, please?
Yes, of course. I think the way I describe it is, I think we're in a position where we can be the most effective bridge between the world of schools and the world that they're going to go into after they finish their education. Now, you can always talk theory to students as to what the world of work is like, what they should be aspiring for. But if they're in a position where they can have someone in the classroom who they can quiz, ask lots of questions, be very inquisitive about, but you also use your experience from the world of work to say, well, this is why we need to do certain things, whether it's the way we talk, whether it's the way we interact, or whether the way we're focused on certain aspects of our studies. I think there is undoubtedly something extra that we can bring to the table as a result of all that extra experience that we've gained outside the world of schools.
Can I press you on that a bit further? Because instinctively, that's got to be true, hasn't it? I mean, we've been in the world of work for so long. But how do we impart it to our students? You know, are you talking about something that is kind of ad hoc, that you are just dishing up along with your Sokotoa or whatever it is you're teaching them? Or are you talking about something more formal that is sort of bolted alongside regular lessons?
So the longer I've spent in schools, now it's coming up to 3 years, I would say it's become much more embedded into what I do. And I've now also become more systematic about it as well. With every new class, I now make a point, having received feedback on the first time I did that, of always opening up with a session, which is about sharing my story, my background, why I'm in the classroom. That also includes showing a clip of the Now Teach video that you kindly made a couple of years ago. Now, you do get a reaction from the students from that, and then that sets it up for ongoing discussions during the course of the year. Now, after a couple of years in teaching, I've also been fortunate enough, having sort of stuck my hand up to say I can probably do a little bit more on careers now. I now do also have, like many of the others on the panel, an official careers role as well. So we do set up specific sessions where that's now building on me having initially set up my story, told them my story, and I start up now, I want to hear about what your story is going to be. And then you build it up from there. And then within the lessons, very often we find ourselves diverting into topics that will be sort of about how what we're studying will apply in the real world. And I'm much happier to sort of allow that to happen in the classroom, and that's become a much more regular feature. And I think the more time I've spent in the classroom, the more confident I've been in deviating from what I might have prepared as my lesson plans in order to ensure that holistic discussion can take place in the classroom.
Peter, do you agree with that? So as a maths teacher, well, first of all, how much do you tell your kids about your previous glittering career as a banker? Do they care? And also, can you embed real world stuff in teaching Sokotoa, etc.? Because when I was a maths teacher, I found that very, very hard.
Yeah, I think, you know, what we do, we offer, you know, is the linking school rules to work, I think is a very important skill that we don't teach necessarily in schools. So, for instance, why do you need to be entering silently? Why do you need to dress well? Why do you need to go into a routine that potentially the child doesn't really understand why they have to do that? It's like, why can't you just have a day off because you're not feeling very well? Why is that important in work? And I think, you know, for me, not many people can understand, especially from the background where my children are, that what an investment banker does is it's just quite outside of their realms of understanding when they first meet me. And so it's a gentle process of getting students to understand what investment banking does, how interesting it can be, why finance is important, and just taking them on a journey through year 7 all the way through to year 13. I generally would be more talking about my background, coming from a relatively positive background myself, and how and why I became motivated through learning in lessons and becoming very good at maths, and where that took me through my journey through my career to becoming, you know, global heads of institutions. And the children, once they're hooked into that story, become much more motivated themselves, because they can see that it's not just somebody in front of them that's just gone to university and come back into come to teach them, nor is it some old person that's actually just been at teaching for the last 20 years. It's somebody that's coming in fresh from their career and showing that there is a motivational level through learning to educate and being attentive in lessons and being attentive to the routines and procedures in school and why it matters for that to happen.
That's absolutely fascinating, because as a journalist, I really can't help them at all on the rules, because journalists never follow any of them. But the investment banking thing is fascinating too. I mean, I didn't set up Now Teach to encourage more people to become investment bankers, but more school kids to become, because I think we've got plenty already. But I did mention one day to my economics class how much investment bankers earned, and the laziest boy came up to me. I don't think we're allowed to say lazy, but I think you know what I mean, came up to me at the end of the lesson and said, "Miss, how do I become an investment banker?" And I said, "Well, Chibuke, you must work a lot harder and you must get a 9 in your blah, blah, et cetera, et cetera." And he's just finished and he has indeed, well, I mean, they're not real grades this year, but he has done absolutely brilliantly. So I think it was dropping that salary of the investment banker that made the difference. Anne-Marie, what about you? How much does any of that resonate? Oh, you're on mute, Anne-Marie.
I'm so sorry. It all resonates very much. I mean, if I'm honest, I think most of my pupils aren't very interested in my previous experience as a standalone thing, but woven into, as other people have said, woven into other conversations, they are interested. And I think it's very important to link behavioural issues with the world of work. And that's why it matters that you turn up on time. That's why it matters that you honour commitments. That's why it matters that you listen to other people. And I enjoy being able to link skills. So I'm teaching languages. I enjoy being able to link saying I too learned French from knowing no French at all in year 7 to a job where I lived and worked in Brussels and worked only in French. And it's completely possible to get from a starting point of 0 at age 11 to working in French. And here's the proof that you've done it. And they do find that interesting. It does make sense of why we got to do this, Miss. Latin is a slightly harder sell, but I feel very passionately that Latin is a wonderful subject for them to learn. And can also say it's what took me to a great university, and I learned a huge amount from it, and I can bluff my way in many languages because of it.
So Ian, from the point of view of somebody who is in charge of dispensing education to students, how important do you think all of this is, this sort of hinterland that all of us have? Is it a detail or is it more fundamental?
I think there's two sides to this coin. You've got the positive side, which is increasing diversity amongst teaching staff. You have people with a very rich background, very rich experiences, who bring a lot with them in terms of weather-beaten worldwide experience. You've got a raft of stories that you can draw on. Oh, that's all really positive. And interestingly, I think actually the pupils are and students are more interested in that than other teachers are. I think a lot of other teachers just do not want to hear old war stories. You know, who cares? You know, it doesn't matter. But I think the students actually very much like them and enjoy them. And especially if you can link them and mix them into lessons, which I know is a bit of a challenge sometimes, and curriculum may not always allow that without a bit of stretch. I think that can be a very powerful experience. So there's that sort of positive side of it, which I think adds a great deal of richness. Perhaps on the other side of that coin is that sometimes people can be regarded as a bit of museum pieces. You know, you're interesting in theory and, you know, you're good to look at and listen to a bit, but what relevance is your life experience to the life that I, as a 12, 13, 14-year-old, am going to have over the next 30, 40 years? And I think there's a bit of selling there around how some of the more traditional careers, are they going to be open to students? Are there things that you can bring that actually will resonate with people who are making decisions about what they're going to do? Because I think the future career paths are going to look very, very different. So I think that side of it, yeah, if you can make the balance between making your experience relevant without looking like a bit of a dinosaur, then you're doing very well.
Yeah, okay, so speaking as a leading dinosaur, I recognize what you say, because it's very easy to think, oh, I understand the world of work because I've done it for 40 years, without actually acknowledging that the world of work has changed beyond all recognition in all of our sectors since we started out. So, and be very aware of that. But there's something else that culture is, you touched on. It's this thing about constantly, not exactly interrupting your lessons, but enriching your lessons with sort of non-curriculum material. Now, I agonize about this, because partly I think, especially in economics, you know, there's no point to studying economics if you don't connect it with the news. I mean, what is the point? So I'm absolutely, you know, I force every child to come to every lesson with a news story, because I may pick on them at any point during the lesson to tell it to me. And if they don't, I give them a detention. So I'm really, really, really care about that. But that is valuable lesson time that I'm not teaching them, you know, about elasticity of supply. Am I doing them a favor or not? Now, this is something that really troubles me. I haven't sorted out. And can I just open to any of you on whether you're bothered by this at all, or whether you think it's actually straightforward and you've got the answer? So none of you, that makes me think that none of you. Okay, Anne-Marie.
I'm not going to say I have the answer. I do think, though, we clearly have a responsibility to prepare the children we teach for exams. And that matters hugely, because that's their gateway to everything else. So that's got to come first. And if there's no time for anything else, then there's no time for anything else. But if we can craft some time to bring in information about other places, other experiences, how this fits into the wider world, it's so valuable. And if just one child lights up with interest, then I think that is a marvellous thing we're doing. You mentioned talking to someone about what investment bankers earn. I think it's really important to talk about money. And how we're often a bit shy about talking about money, but my pupils are really interested in it, because in the main they don't have much. And so I quite often link things to this helps you get this sort of job, and you'll earn more doing that kind of job than some other jobs. I'm really glad I can do that, and they believe me because they think I'm so old I must know.
For me, I think there's a couple of really interesting questions that came out then. Currently, the craze on Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies and trading that within my year 12 and year 13 students is quite bizarre that's something they want to do. And you can see it because of the posting on Twitters and all the Snapchats and everything that's going on. And actually stopping children doing that and understanding that it is a gambling, and that it is a, you know, an addictive form of gambling, and that you potentially could get a career out of it, but you need to work very hard and thinking about how much you could lose, is something that we've spent some time on at our schools. And I think it's very interesting also talking about the new career culture. You know, ever since I was in school, there was this whole thing about there's going to be a whole new, brand new set of career culture that's going to be coming forward. And in fact, the general population are still doing the general jobs that have been around for a number of years. And that's not to say there are new ways of working and there are new jobs coming out all the time. But however, we do have a large amount of experience reinventing and inventing things all the way through our careers. And that's why generally the majority of our teachers have been successful, because they are able to reinvent and keep up with the current trend of careers as we're working.
Because just going back to this question of time spent purely drilling curriculum, teaching exam technique. I mean, you know, the trouble with teaching is there's not enough time. You know, our lessons are short and the curriculum is long. Do you agonize about times where you've strayed and wonder whether that's in the pupil's best interests or not?
Perhaps not as much as I'm sensing that you have done, because I start from the premise, and there's always quite a lot of opportunities, I think, where it doesn't have to be contradictory. So if you look at recent times, for example, the COVID situation has provided lots of opportunities to talk about data, statistics, and weave that into maths lessons in multiple ways. If you talk about the financial situation which ordinary families are experiencing, whether it's pay now, buy now, pay later, all these different forms of credit and so on. And there's quite a lot of things that you can weave directly into maths lessons without it feeling like you're moving away from the curriculum. But ultimately, I think there is an element of, if the kids aren't engaged, if they don't see the relevance of what you're doing in the classroom, well, you can spend the 5 hours on it, but if they're not engaged, that's not going to be as productive. But if out of those 5 hours, actually you spent half an hour of that, getting them buzzing a little bit more, then the other 4.5, they will actually do a lot more of what you're looking to do in the curriculum. So I try and persuade myself, perhaps, that it's not contradicting itself and it has at least some motivational value in the short term, as far as the exams are concerned, and hopefully at least in the long term, in terms of preparing themselves for later life.
Well, that makes me feel, I'm not sure if I agree, but I hope I agree. What do you think, Ian? Do you think that there is a trade-off here? And if there is, which side of it do you come down on?
Well, I was just thinking about listening to what people are saying then. I think if we just teach the curriculum, that's quite dull. Well, actually, it might be a fascinating curriculum. I shouldn't say that. But if that's all you rigorously stick to, what do I remember when I look back many years ago when I was doing my O-levels and A-levels, as they were? And I remember the rather idiosyncratic teachers who added a little bit more and had a little bit of flair and were prepared to go that further outside the curriculum and share some of their experience. Now, obviously, Now Teach didn't exist then, but I can remember people who had skills they developed. And I'm thinking of people who taught almost, there was a geography guy who used to create the most wonderful pictures on the blackboard, which dates me in itself. But they were works of art, and you just sit there and we'd all take down the keynotes, and you know, you could hear a pin drop in that lesson. Yeah, and I went to a very average comprehensive in the 1970s. So there weren't that many lessons where you could hear bins drops, but that one you could. And I thought, well, this is somebody bringing the skill they've got outside and they've really applied it and it makes it come alive. And I think if you can do that, almost irrespective of your age or background, then that is adding something. I'd hate to think that anybody in my schools wasn't able to do that in the curriculum time. I'd really hate to think that.
Oh, well, maybe I should come and work in your school. I think I'd be very happy indeed. So can I see you after this panel and ask you for a job? No, look, I agree with that completely. And in a way, the moment that I'm proudest of in my teaching career, I was meant to be teaching the labour market. And we were talking about how different people got paid different amounts of money. And then I decided to role play asking for a pay rise. So I had the kids. You know, I thought no one taught me that. It took me until I was 50 to ask for a pay rise. So I had them. One was being the investment banking, where they negotiate bonuses. One was, you know, being the boss, and the other was trying to think of good arguments why they deserve more money. And I really think I was adding value. But if I compare myself to my other colleagues who was teaching them absolutely rigorously how to answer a 9-mark exam question, which ones will do better in their GCSEs? So I'm not, I think there is a trade-off, and I'm so delighted with my panel on what side we appear to be coming down. So thanks very much for that. Now, look, the next thing that we hoped, this is a tricky one, but that we hoped we would be able to help with, is in some of the in the running of schools. If you think about the combined managerial experience of Now Teachers, it's absolutely phenomenal. But why I'm kind of being a bit cagey about this is that sort of humility comes in here too. We realized that it was going to be a catastrophe if our people showed up sort of going, oh, you know, this isn't a way to run a piss up in a brewery, etc. When they actually have no idea about the functioning of schools and how they work. So it's only now that we're becoming more experienced, we're beginning to see ways in which, in the most tactful way, helpful way possible, we may be able to provide some skills that are lacking in schools. Peter, to what extent have you managed to do this?
I think it's a really interesting question. I think, you know, when we first walked in and Now Teach, we all came from from relatively high power jobs, and we decided that, you know, we're going to take on education, and this is, you know, we can show some really good ideas from the world of the private sector into the public sector. And I think what we in the first cohort managed to understand quite quickly and pass on was that we were absolute novices in the education system. And there's lots to learn that we didn't know needed to happen first. So I think one of the nice things from most of the NOW teachers is that we are fairly patient and build up an array of understanding about what we need to do. That doesn't mean that frustrations don't creep in occasionally, but certainly we become patient. And what does that mean? So it meant that, you know, the first 6 months or so, I spent time talking to the senior leadership team and being with the senior leadership team and just seeing what they're doing and why they're doing it and trying to understand how the whole education system put together. And then it's then becoming integrated into that process. So, for instance, I helped build behaviour and detention sheets and be able to start looking at data and finding when problems were occurring and what rooms these problems were in and how we could then support with other members of staff about number of send-outs and how we could where people needed to be on a daily basis to make sure that we reduced the issues within both classroom and within the school itself.
Interrupt and ask what you did specifically to build up the trust among the senior leadership team that you, with your lack of experience in education, really did have something that they ought to listen to.
So as I said, the first thing I did was take the data that we were collecting in our education systems and build spreadsheets so that we could analyse that data much more accurately and much more closely in order to be able to. Get detentions and be able to understand where the detentions were taking place and how to take the burden of a very cumbersome system into something that was very easy to understand for every member of the leadership team and also of the teaching staff.
And did you take that upon yourself, or did you just see a gap that you might be able to help solve and just do it, or had somebody suggested that you might help?
So as I said, I was shadowing a few people just to see what they did on a daily basis, and I noticed that they were constantly doing the same set of processes over and over again that took half an hour or 40 minutes at a time. And I said, well, we could do this in 3 minutes if we actually did it analytically. And that saves them a significant portion of their day.
Ian, listening to that, do you can you see that sort of thing happening in your school? Do you think there's more scope for us to help in ways like this? And if so, how do we bring it about without looking as if we're interfering in a world of work that we're still novices in?
I think this is a tough one, because on paper you think you've got lots of people with, you know, 20, 30 years plus management experience, and schools would welcome that and would lead on it. And I don't think schools do. I think head teachers feel a bit threatened and they're a bit suspicious of it, and it wasn't learnt in schools, so therefore it's most likely not relevant. And in some cases that is true, because I think organisations such as schools are very hierarchical and very top down. And lots of modern organisations are not that. They're very flat, they're very open, they invite comments bubbling up from the bottom. Schools, less so. Not all of them, but less so. And I don't exclude my schools from that criticism either. I don't think we're great at this. I think you have to almost serve your apprenticeship as a NOW teach before anybody wants to give you time of day. Where I do think there are opportunities, and we just begin to see it happen within our trust, is in things like pastoral care, where somebody with a massive amount of experience and things can be incredibly the right person at the right time to provide that sort of support and guidance for pupils, but also can manage some challenging parents very, very effectively. So I think there's lots of opportunity there. Do I think overall we are, horrible word, but leveraging NOW teachers and their vast range of experience successfully? No, we're not. But I think over the next 3 or 4 years, we may get there. We may get there a bit better as people learn to accept it and listen.
Do you have any advice either for other school leaders or for the Now teachers on how to manage it better? I mean, what you say rings a resounding bell with me. I come from journalism, which is the flattest hierarchy of all. I was absolutely used to strolling into the editor's office saying, oh, I don't think much of this. And I waited 2 or 3 years in my current school thinking, now I really do know how to teach a bit and I've earned the right to speak. And I have been taking to paying very unwelcome visits to my head teacher to tell him what I think of this, that, and the other, and it's gone down exceptionally poorly on the whole.
I think that would be a common experience for many people. Head teachers, they'll ask for opinions when they want it, and they may not necessarily want it even then. But you know, it's very unwelcome, I think, for people to chip up and chip in.
But it does seem a waste. How do we change this, or don't we even try?
Well, I think as partly it's some of the programs that head teachers go through to pick up their own management experience need to change. Mm. I think they're still quite old fashioned. I think they're still rooted in very old behavioral psychology. I'm thinking of we've had a couple of wins recently where we're fortunate enough to have a senior part, ex-senior part from Accenture as one of our Now Teach teachers, and we were rebidding our IT contract. So it was very helpful just to sort of amble down there with the tenders and say, would you mind having a quick look at these and cast your eye over this? And you get a rich stream of feedback there. So we're learning to leverage it a bit better, but I think we've got a long way to go. I have to temper my own approaches when dealing with teachers because I'm not a teacher by background. Yeah. And therefore I have to judge it when I can be challenging, and I have to judge it where I have to listen more, and I have to judge it where, you know, actually I need to bow to other people's greater experience.
Anne-Marie, can I ask you on the pastoral side that Ian mentioned, because I think you have been able to help in that way, in a way that your 22-year-old self might not have been able to.
I think that's true. I do think my age comes as an advantage, particularly when talking to parents. And I do leverage also the fact that I am a parent, but I think the age is as relevant as that. I think parents have a really difficult job to do, and parents who are struggling economically, as many of the parents of my pupils are, parents who may not always have lived in this country and whose first language may not be English are struggling. COVID has made that much, much worse. And they often need an awful lot of support too. So I do find that in making all the calls we all make, pastoral calls home about pupils, parents need a lot of help and a lot of support. And I do, having been quite tentative to start with, I do now talk a lot more personally about the challenges of parenting. I malign my son terribly, who's a grown-up, adult, sensible teacher, in fact, and talk a lot about all the terrible things he did as a teenager, most of which are really, if not invented, then greatly exaggerated. But they provide a way of talking about how to handle a difficult teenage boy. And I think parenting can be a lonely job, and being able to talk to someone and give them support in that regard can only help the education of their children. And that's what I want to do.
Yeah, I completely agree with that, to the point where I'm really quite a soft touch with parenting, because I do remember how horrible it was to go parent evening after parents evening and be told how badly both my sons were doing. Not fun. And the idea that if a teacher tells you your son's doing badly, that you can somehow wave a magic wand and they'll do well. Well, if I knew how to do that, I would have done it already. Which way do you think you have been able to help the school through the law? Have you managed to deploy your old life in any way, or is that yet to come?
I think that's very much yet to come, hopefully at some stage. I would say, however, there is no shortcut to learning teaching. And actually, as a new teacher, it hasn't been a problem for me. That the priority has been, how do I establish myself in the classroom and become a good teacher? So a lot of that has been about picking the brains of others. I guess in the informal discussions, one of the things I think you can bring to the table is, whatever is the current fashion in teaching, having sort of worked for a number of years, you can say, look, every industry, things come in fashion and everybody does certain things in a religious way. 5 or 6 years later, they think that's the stupidest thing that they were ever doing. And actually, making people pause and think, well, actually, there are things in teaching as well. If you talk to the more experienced teachers, where they also there were things they were doing 7-8 years ago. So let us always pause and ask ourselves the question why a little bit more, not lose sense of the sense of purpose. Mm. And also, if it genuinely makes sense, give people a bit more courage to say, well, let's do it slightly differently. So actually that little bit of small encouragement is probably what I'm doing at the moment, I'd say. And also just making people not assume that just because certain things are done the way they are, if they feel that it could be done differently, have the confidence to articulate that. Mm-hmm. Encouraging people to do that a bit more is probably a small contribution I'm trying to make at this stage.
You see, that's absolutely fascinating and leads on to my next thing, which is what, if anything, we have to give to our colleagues, to our younger, the younger teachers who surround us in school. When Now Teach was born, this wasn't something I was even thinking of. I mean, you know, I was thinking of how do we help the schools? How do we help the pupils? But actually, my biggest area of help, I sometimes think, is to the young teachers who surround me in doing the sort of thing that you talk about in sort of saying, oh, it's a fad, you know, this too will pass, but also in helping them with office politics and helping them manage their workload. You know, so many teachers have come straight from university. They think if they're told they've got to double mark everything, they're there, they get incredibly stressed out. And so I feel that I've become the unofficial shop steward in a way, saying you've done 10 hours work today without a break. You shouldn't be expected to work harder than that. Diminishing returns will set in. Prioritize what you need to do and off you go. Go home, don't take anything with you. And they look at me in complete amazement. But I genuinely think that I am helping them by doing that. Peter, have you been a bit of a father of, because I see you as a father of chapel, personality-wise. Have you been doing a bit of that?
Yes, I mean, I think one thing that really changed at our school was part-time working. So I'm working 4 days a week, and most of the Now teachers are working 4 days a week as well. When we rocked into our current school, when we came into our current school, there was a number of, every Now teacher was going to do 4 days a week. There weren't many people doing 4 days a week working. And we've now changed that completely in school, where I'd suggest now we're at the point where a vast majority of teachers are now doing part-time or 4 days a week working. And I think that's really works for a really healthy work-life balance. I think it means that students get much better commitment from the teachers, because they are able to take a bit of a break in between each week to let off some steam. And whilst we all know we can't do school hours means nothing, you have to work over and above that. It means that you can actually have some time to yourself. And secondly, and I completely agree with what you're saying, Lucy, you know, I've spent a significant amount of time just telling trainee teachers just to go home, 5 o'clock, it's time to start packing up. And they see myself and other middle leaders doing that. And that means that they're following that culture rather than the culture of working until 8-9 o'clock every night. They're seeing the culture of, okay, leave school at 5:30, 6 o'clock. And seeing that that's not detrimental to their career.
I'm amazed at the part-time thing, because I thought this was it. I absolutely agree. One of the things that Now teachers really, really pushed on is the part-time working. If teacher retention is a problem, which it most definitely is, part-time has got to be part of that solution. But I see it as very unfair that I work only 3 days a week, and my colleagues, the reason that they don't follow me doing that is not because they're, you know, they wouldn't love to, it's because they can't afford to. And so I feel almost guilty about how untired I am by comparison to them. And when they're just going, I'm staggering through to the end of term, I have to say, yes, so am I, rather than say, oh, really, are you? I feel fine. So that is not an area of great support. Amory, I bet you're the most supportive colleague in the known universe.
I try to be a supportive colleague, and I think I've had lots of experience of managing people in my previous world. So although I don't really manage anybody now. I mentor at an NQT, but I don't have any serious management responsibilities. I certainly do use that. And actually, my head of department quite often will informally ask for just to talk things through. And I love doing that. I am very, very clear. I don't want to be a head teacher, deputy head teacher, head of department, any of those things. Absolutely not interested. And I like to make that known because I think it also makes it clear I'm not in any kind of competition for any of those roles. Mm. I just want to get to be a better teacher, and I can learn lots from other people, but I'm happy to share the things I have learned in my more managerial roles from that previous life of mine. And I talk through things quite often with people about managing people, managing time, which is so difficult. And I love doing it.
Mm. You're absolutely right that if you like, I mean, I agree with you. I'm not trying to climb the ladder at all. And that means that I can agitate from below. Kosras, what about you? Are you going to take over the universe in your school, or are you going to continue to toil away in the classroom and not seek promotion?
Well, for me, undoubtedly, the priority is the classroom and the students. As I say to others, if it was about pure ambition, I probably would have stayed in my previous job for a decade longer. So that certainly helps. What you find is the 22 years or so I did spend in the city meant that you can tell stories about different types of styles of leadership, different types of characters that you came across. So when you're seeing what are very often young managers in their first managerial roles encountering difficult interactions and so on, and then everyone's getting all a bit worked up about that, there's often quite a lot you can do to talk people into a bit of sense and just make sure that everything's calmed down a little bit more as well. I think with some of the, I'd say, those that I've worked more closely with, who are even though they might be my mentor or my team head, etc., in slightly more senior positions, you do find yourself informally advising them on how to manage change, how to manage teams, etc. And I think they do benefit from that counsel to a certain extent. And I think being a trusted colleague or trusted advisor with a bit of extra experience without a vested interest, if you can come across as that, I think there is a lot to be said for that.
I should tell the audience, just before this session went live, we were having a joke about the ways that the more experienced career changers do not benefit schools. And in my case, and Anne-Marie, I hope you don't mind me saying so, it is our atrocious use of technology. So questions are meant to be coming in through a platform that until 45 minutes ago I'd never heard of, called slido.com. I can't see any right now, which could well be that I'm being fantastically stupid. So if any of the organizers could pop them in the chat function, that would be extremely kind. But otherwise, that there are still things that I'm longing to find out from our panel. I mean, one of these is about status of teaching and what we can do there. Ian, does it trouble you that the status of teachers, I mean, without actually having been one yourself, do you see this as a problem, that in this country the status of teachers is still too low? And if so, do you think there's anything that we Now Teach could do either individually or as an organization to change that?
I think that might have been historically truer than it is now. I think over the last 18 months, if there's one thing that's probably come out of COVID and lockdown and homeschooling, is a significant uplift in respect for the what teachers do and how they maintain that focus and delivery and take the pressure off parents. So I don't share some of the premises of that. It is still a low status profession. I think it's changed and changed, but very positively, certainly over the last 10 years. I think one of the things I'm very conscious of, just echoing what people were saying earlier, is Now Teach and experienced teachers, there's a sort of mature ballast that they bring to the ship of teaching in schools where, as you said, you're not as competitive, you're not looking for the next assistant headship or deputy headship. You're generally that Now teachers are generally there because they want to teach the subjects. But they've climbed the pyramid somewhere else, they've done all that, they know that you get to the top of the pyramid and all it gets you to is the bottom of another pyramid, and so that may not be the main motivator, but the delivery and the engagement with pupils is the motivator. So I think that's a big one. And I'm fascinated with what Peter was saying about part-time teaching. In my group of sort of five schools, I think it ranges between about 7 to a maximum of 12% of our teachers work part-time. And there's quite a lot of pushback from senior teachers about employing part-timers. So I'm going to have a think about that and work out how we can actually make something a bit more flexible happen.
I have just about mastered this platform, but because my eyes are so weak on account of my advanced age, I'm peering at the screen very, very closely. I haven't gone mad. I'm just trying to read the questions. Here's one that I really like. It says, would you have gone straight into teaching instead of your previous career routes? Kosras, do you want to start off on that?
Well, for me, actually, sort of teaching was a possibility when I graduated. I toyed with the idea of becoming an academic rather than going into the city. And part of that is the story that I share with the with my own students, with my own personal background, having been born in Bangladesh, for having had parents who were doing manual jobs. I felt daunted at the prospect of going into a leading city institution and joining that as someone who would be very different to the vast majority of people that were out there. But equally, I knew that basically if I did say yes to that opportunity as my lecturer and one of a postgraduate student counseled me at the time, that that would enable me to find my feet, help my family, etc. So, and an opportunity which not many people turned down. So when one of the leading law firms offered me that training contract, I did go with that. But there was a part of me that felt that was a bit of a compromise. And so it has been in the back of my mind, even when I was sort of in the early days, I'd often say to my fellow city workers that this is not something I intend to do for my entire life. And often they would just nod knowingly, yes, of course. And then when you came along and launched Now Teach and I came across that, that was coincided with the point at which I thought, well, actually now is the right time to transition. So I'm comfortable with the idea of sort of spending the first half of my career in the city, but the second half of my career in teaching. But the seeds of that undoubtedly were always there.
So it was always there. Anne-Marie, was it always there for you?
I was very determined never to be a teacher. My father was a teacher, like many of us were. I had some in our family who are teachers, and it just didn't look like that much fun to me. So no, absolutely not. And even when I read your article, I was protesting, no, of course I'm not going to be a teacher. As everyone around me said, of course it's obvious you're going to be a teacher, apart from my children, who still think I'm far too impatient.
I mean, I think the vocational thing is so fascinating. I have a mum who was a teacher, and exactly like you, Anne-Marie, I spent the first 30 years of my professional life trying to be as unlike my mother as possible. Now I just can't. Now she seems to be controlling my every move, even my grey hair from beyond the grave. Peter, teachers in your family?
No teachers in my family. It was always in the background of when I... of what I thought I'd do when I left my my career, but unfortunately for me, money was just too important. I wanted to go into something that had significant amount of money, and as you said, Lucy, the issue we have with part-time teaching is that teaching is an underpaid profession for what it is, and people can't afford to do what they need.
Yeah, although better paid than it once was. Another interesting question: are we preparing young people properly for the world of work? Ian, start with you on that.
It's getting better, but I think there's a lot of work to be done. We still run quite traditional careers fairs, which a lot of effort goes into, but I'm not sure you actually get the interaction and you get the right experience there. And I don't think we're addressing some of the things that our students want to hear. So I think there's a lot of work to be done there. There's a lot of DfE initiatives in this area, and they've increased the requirement for schools to deliver on that. But my sort of gut feel is it's still about 10, 15 years out of date. There's a lot more we could do.
Kosras, thoughts?
It still very much feels like across schools as a whole, it's something that's done at the edges and the margins. And the more you interact with the kids, and especially even when you talk to some of the brightest students, so I will, one of our brightest students year 10, when I was speaking to him recently, for example, let it be known that he was aspiring to become an accountant. So I told him, well, what do you know about the world of accountancy? Well, out of the four big firms, he was only able to name one of them and then started naming a number of other financial institutions. So that just gives you a snapshot of how little they're exposed to so much of the world. The ambition is there, the aspiration is there, but they definitely need to interact on a much more regular basis with people from the world of work to have a deeper level of understanding, which will enable them to sort of fulfill those ambitions that they definitely have.
I completely agree. I don't think schools have cracked this at all, both in terms of the skills that will be needed and in terms of the knowledge about the sorts of jobs they might go into. One of the questions says, how did you become involved with your careers role in the school? Was this requested by SLT due to your previous career, or did you volunteer? Well, actually, I'm not formally involved. Nobody has asked me. And I think that's very typical of a lot of us, that we sort of must in a bit and sort of help out on an ad hoc basis. But I mean, still, the careers for my students, the careers advice doesn't seem to be that much better than it was for me, however many, you know, 40 plus years ago, that they have a careers interview that sort of doesn't really amount to very much. And so I think in the future, as I think about how I would like Now Teach to develop, that we can really bring together all of our experience and put together some sort of package that is really, really helpful to the students. Anne-Marie, what's your thoughts on that?
As you know, I'm the careers coordinator at my school, and I was asked to apply for that role because of my previous experience. Yeah. I think it is fascinating and frustrating to try and open people's minds to all the opportunities that are out there. The first thing that we did when I took on this role was we took our year 10 pupils to a careers fair in the City of London, and I built around it a sort of walking tour of the city. A huge proportion, over three quarters of the pupils that we took on this trip from Brixton, had never seen the River Thames. They, for all sorts of reasons, live very much in their locality and had not even seen these places, let alone met people who might work in them. And so the more we can do, I think, just to introduce our pupils to people who work in different places and have different experiences, the greater the service that we are doing. The more we believe that they, and tell them we believe that they can do roles like this, then the better we are doing for them as well. But it's very hard, particularly, of course, after COVID, when things like work experience have just not been happening.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And one of the ways in which we should be able to help as well is using our contacts. That was something that right from the beginning seemed obvious to me, that our own children have contacts. They were born that way, and most of our students do not. And that seems one of the greatest unfairnesses of life. I'm now getting prompts saying that I must wrap up. There's 1 minute and 26 seconds. Quickly, a last word from each of you in a couple of seconds on your experience as being a late stage teacher, starting with Khosrows.
Go for it. I haven't looked back and regretted it since doing it, but it's tough, and be prepared for a tough transition.
Couldn't agree more. Peter?
It's fantastic. I don't look back. I've had two different careers. This is my second career, and I'm looking forward to another 20 years of doing this.
You're younger than me, but I'm still going to do it till I'm 75. Anne-Marie?
I have never been so tired. I have never been so emotionally volatile, but I also have never had as much fun as a teacher.
Absolutely fantastic. Ian, are you tempted to become a teacher? You're not too young. You're considerably younger than I am. How about it?
We're the same generation, but thank you. I was just thinking, my mother was a teacher, my grandfather was a teacher, two cousins of mine are teachers, so there may be teaching in the blood. I really enjoyed my prior careers. I went all over the place, had a great time, really interesting. But in terms of satisfaction and reward and enjoyment, what I'm doing now is probably the best of anything I've ever done previously. So, yes, I think education is great, and it's great to do it at this time of life as well.
How very upbeat. What a brilliant way to end. Thank you, wonderful panel. That's it.
It's my great honour to welcome you all.
It is a very prestigious award. It means the world to me.
They have great senses of humour.
I like to reveal parts of history to them, for I love making history come alive.
They are some of the best people that you can come across.
To help them open their hearts.
I always come back to this quote. How can we be role models to learners if we're not learners ourselves?
It's quite useful to get out of our bubbles, not our COVID ones, and sort of see what else is out there.
By sharing best practice, we can see the whole picture. We can see what really matters.
Easy to forget how much has to happen behind the front lines.
As a global schools group, Cognita educates over 55,000 students across 12 countries. We're proud to be Wellbeing Partner at this year's Festival of Education, and we want to share the work that we're doing to prioritise children's well-being. This starts with a clear understanding of what well-being is. We looked at the evidence and created a simple Be Well charter that everyone can use day to day. It gives a clear definition of well-being and then focuses on the specific contributors that influence it. Discover our full Be Well charter video and other resources to use with your students and families at cognita.com.
I really try to not look at myself as just a science teacher. I feel like as a teacher, it's very important to help students grow and develop outside of your lessons. A single teacher believing in you and really believing in you. One teacher doing that can have a large impact, but if you have one or two or three all telling you that and really, really believing in it, it makes you feel like you can achieve anything in the world, honestly.
In between, everything I know and all the lies I tell myself so I can sleep. Pick apart the pieces you left, and don't you worry about it. Don't you worry about it. Try and give yourself some rest, and let me worry about it. Let me worry about it. You came around to say that you'd been away like I hadn't known. As if I don't wake up every single day not seeing you go. As if this moon of ours only shines a half to make me feel whole. As if I haven't felt
catch your breath in every step I take when the wind blows. Pick apart the pieces you left, and don't you worry about it, don't you worry about it. Try and give yourself some rest, and let me worry about it, let me worry about it. Pick apart the pieces you left, and don't you worry about it, don't you worry about it. Try and give yourself some rest, and let me worry about it, let me worry about it. Been traveling these wide roads for so long. My heart's been far from you, 10,000 miles gone. Oh, I wanna come near and give you every part of me, but there's blood on my hands and my lips are unclean.